church teaches. Well, those are, that's good, but why do you believe that? I mean, can you defend your faith? We've got the Southeastern Bible Conference coming up over at the college here in just a month or two, and I have been asked to teach a workshop on apologetics, and we'll deal with this issue of the ignorance of contemporary Christians and why we don't know how to defend our faith in our culture. We don't. And so we zip our mouths and we don't say anything. But Genesis chapter 1 and verse number 1, in my opinion, is the most important sentence that's ever been written. It just simply says this: in the beginning, that is time as we know it. Time is the order of events in sequence. There was no time before Genesis 1:1. I don't understand that. I don't understand how time never existed, but it didn't until in the beginning, God, which is, it's a plural term, it's a plural name, God created the heaven and the earth. And the word create is the word bara, and it means to form from nothing. He didn't go to Lowe's and get the lumber. He didn't go anywhere to get anything. He spoke into existence the atoms and the molecules. He spoke into existence, and nothing obeyed and became everything, which is pretty amazing to me. But Judges 21:25 says that in those days there was no king in Israel, and every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Would you like a world like that, by the way, that everybody does what's right in their own eyes? I don't want, because somebody may say, I ain't stopping at that stop sign. That happened a couple of years ago. I was crossing 17 down here, and I had a green light, and I was in the middle of the intersection, and a young man, I don't know if he didn't see it or didn't care. Anyway, he ran that red light and hit my wife's car and totaled her car. And so I'm glad that we have traffic lights to control people's opinions. We have speed limits to control people's speed. You know what I'm saying? And so laws are good, but laws can overstep their bounds and become a bad thing. But what we want to do for the next few minutes, I want to walk through several of the major world views, which will include religions, and see, are these valid or are they invalid? And the first one that I want to mention to you is Islam. Nearly one quarter of the world's population is Muslim. And Muslims believe that Allah, who was the moon god, by the way, in Turkey many, many, many millennia ago, they believe that Allah created everything, set everything in order, and this set of laws that the universe operates by is called Sharia. You ever heard that term? Sharia law. And this set of laws is contained in the Quran, and Islam, the name or the word Islam, means submission. And a Muslim is one who submits to the will of Allah and all of the principles of Allah embodied in what is called the Ummah. And the Ummah is just simply the community of Muslims. You know, it's the group. And here's what Muslims believe. And you tell me if you think this makes sense. Muslims believe that every human being that is born Muslim. And if you get saved, for instance, you become a Christian, you abandoned your original birth religion, and you have to be brought back into the fold. And if it takes blowing up your car or whatever, people need to be brought back into the fold of Islam. And so the Islamic view of God and man are quite different from Christianity. Islam does not believe in the inherited nature of man. They don't believe in the sin nature of man. I think Scripture is very clear about this. Yes, sir. Yes. Oh, yes. Yes, sir. And in some countries, we don't have that here in this country, but in some countries, you are. Yes, sir. Absolutely. The, not only one, it is the. Yeah, it is the fastest. And Islam does not believe that you can have a relationship with Allah. Allah is your master. You just do what you're told. There is no personal relationship like we can have with the Lord in Christianity. But men basically are slaves to Allah, and they view the government. And in Muslim countries, their religion and their government are the same thing. In other words, Islam is the government, and it is also the religion. Now, here in the United States, we believe the two are separate. And even though that is not, the separation of church and state, did you know that is not ever mentioned in the Constitution? That was written in a personal letter from Thomas Jefferson to the Danbury Baptist when the country was being formed. They were a little afraid that the government was going to take over and tell everybody, like they did in England. And Thomas Jefferson said, no, don't worry about that. There's a wall of separation between the church and the state. And the view is that the government will be the religion that brings the world under the rule of Sharia. All right? So does that sound reasonable to you? On the way. Yep. Yes. Well, no. Here's the thing. Christians have a Messiah. Islam has a Messiah. And here's the oddity about that. Our Messiah is their Antichrist. Their Antichrist is our Messiah. Yeah, it's really interesting when you look. Yeah, they look at Christ will be the Antichrist, according to Islamic teaching. Now, here's number two. Secularism. And the secularist is only concerned with right now. Let's not worry about eternity. Let's not worry about the future. They don't believe that you will live in eternity in the presence of God. They don't accept the premise of a spiritual dimension at all. The physical is all there is. This is it. This is heaven. This is hell. This is everything right here in the physical reality. And all that exists is this physical now. That's kind of depressing to me. This is as good as it gets, right here. And so all that exists is what we're experiencing now. In the 1930s, there was a group of atheists and agnostics. Now, an atheist, words mean things, and I'm kind of a word freak. I think that they help me understand things. Atheos. A means no or not. Theos is the Greek word for God. So atheos is what? No God. So an atheist is a person that does not believe in God. And then, you've got the secularist idea that this humanist, it was called the Humanist Manifesto, and it was an outlying of their spiritual views on things. And these old attitudes, there's a God in heaven that loves you, and he sent Jesus to die for your sin, and when you die, you're going to, all that stuff, they consider outdated. Because it's either in the past or it's in the future, but it's not right now. And so this is part of their problem. And so a lot of these agnostics, and again, no or not, gnosis is the Greek word for knowledge, and so an agnostic is one that has no knowledge of God. Maybe he exists, maybe he doesn't, I don't know. So that's an agnostic. And a person, for instance, that is an atheist. If you know someone that claims to be an atheist, number one, that is the most foolish of positions. Because here's what an atheist is saying. I know everything. There is no God, really. You've traveled everywhere. You've been to every planet. You've been to every universe. You've been to every solar system. You're sure there's not a God anywhere in the world. And so, yeah. And so we've got the guy that is saying, I know everything. In order to say there is no God, you are claiming omniscience. And omniscience means that you know everything. Do you know somebody who actually does know everything? Yes, God does. And he has said several times in the Psalms, the fool has said in his heart, there's no God. And so let's say that Let's say that white screen back there represents everything that can be known about everything in the universe. How much of that do we know? Put a dot on the screen as to how much we know of everything. Could you even see the dot? You know, can you see the dot? All right, now, here would be my question to the atheist. So you say there is no God. You're claiming that you know everything. And if somebody actually says, well, yeah, matter of fact, I do, ask them what your social security number is. What's my mother's maiden name? Well, I don't know. Oh, really? Is it possible that there's something else you don't know? Like, God exists. And so, here's the best we can do. You've got this little dot on the screen. Look at all the white, which represents that which we do not know. Is it possible that God exists and he doesn't know it? Is that possible? Not only is it possible, that's the way it is. And so, the secularist believes in what's called materialism. And in other words, the only thing that exists is matter. There is no spiritual dimension to life. They believe in this world. They live for this world, and that's it. They think that when they die, they're like Rover. They're dead all over. And that is completely false because we are what we understand to be a tripartite being. We have a body and a soul and spirit. Animals have a body. You know, technically, animals have a soul, which is mind, will, and emotions, and they have all three of those, but they don't have spirit. They don't know God exists. They're not going to go to heaven when they die, so there is no such thing. Sorry if anybody's going to touch somebody. There is no rainbow bridge that when Buffy dies, you know, Buffy crosses around. I see people post this on Facebook all the time. You know, our kitty died and crossed the rainbow bridge, and no, your kitty died. Okay, can we stop right there? The kitty didn't cross the rainbow bridge. And so anyway, this doctrinal position is that everything that does exist can be explained through natural processes. Everything that exists, you can see, you can touch. Well, let me ask you this. How can you measure loyalty? Have you ever seen loyalty? Can you touch it? Can you smell loyalty? Can you weigh it? How about love? Can you measure love? Can you see it? No, you can't smell it. It is a non-material truth. And so there are many things that we cannot see. Wind. You can't see wind. So are we going to say it doesn't exist because we can't see it? I don't think so. Every hurricane's ever been through here has proved to me wind is a real deal. You can't see it. You can see the results of it. And so this is the doctrinal position that God is irrelevant and probably even dangerous. And if you ever talk to a secularist and you bring up your belief in God, you're going to see his hackles raise. Because if there's a God, this destroys the premise of their worldview. That there is no God, all there is the physical right now, and we don't believe in a God. Matter of fact, probably God, the idea of God is dangerous. Now, they are people of faith. Every body on earth worships somebody. There's no such thing as a person who does not worship. Does the atheist worship? Yes. Who's he worship? Himself. The atheist worships himself. The ultimate values and the ultimate beliefs, the ultimate opinions are mine. And so that which you surrender yourself to for obedience, that's your God. And so, yes, the atheist worships and the agnostic worships and the Buddhist worships. Yeah, everybody worships, but not everybody worships the only God that is revealed in the Bible, the only God there is, and that is the Jehovah God of the Bible. Now, let's look at another one, Marxism. One in five people in the world live under a Marxist regime. In the 20th century alone, this is the last century, Marxism murdered over 100 million people. That doesn't work for me. You know, a faith that has to do that in order to replicate itself, that does not work for me. Karl Marx, who was the granddaddy of what we're talking about right now, he hated with every cell of his being, he hated capitalism. Now, the United States, our economic system is based on a capitalistic form of economy. Personally, I think capitalism is the best kind, the best form of economy in the world. Now, can it be abused? Sure it can. Sure it can. Can a butter knife be abused? Yeah, I can kill you with a butter knife. And so just because somebody abuses something doesn't mean it's wrong. It means it hasn't been used properly. And but capitalism is this truth. I make a widget, whatever it is, and it costs me $5 to make that widget. I put it in my store and I sell it for $7. That's $2 profit. And there are people in this country right now that have the idea that profit is wicked. Is it? No, it's not wicked. Now, can you abuse it? Like they did in Miami when the hurricanes came through and they jacked the price of gasoline 3 times? Yes, you can abuse that. And somebody like that, I think, should be jailed for gouging, and especially in a time like that. But eventually, here's what happens. It begins with socialism. And what I'm talking about is that the means of production and distribution are owned by the government. There's no such thing as private property. Karl Marx hated the idea of private property. If you own something, you don't have the right to own an acre of land or a house that should belong to the community or to the government. That doesn't work for me. And so this it starts with socialism, which kicks off with, ready? Heavy taxation. Okay, the government's got to have money because you're aware that the government does not produce a product or service. Where do they get their money? Get it from us. Exactly right. They produce nothing as far as a product is concerned. And so the government should never, ever try to compete with its tax base for services or products. Insurance right now, as a matter of fact. Government insurance, why is that not a fair playing field? Government and private industry. Because the government can print money. I can't print money. If I need $5 million to stay in business, I'm kind of messed up. If the government needs $5 million, they go to printing press and print $20 million. And so we've got that problem. And then you've got government control of business. You have the elimination of laws protecting private property. You have the government now trying to dismantle your constitutional rights. And now you watch. Trump got shot in the ear last night. What is the first thing that people start screaming about in a situation like that? We got to get these guns out of people's hands. All right, we've got it's coming, and this is just my opinion. I don't think we'll ever know who shot him. You will never know what his background was. You might not ever even know his real name. But anyway, eventually the means of production and distribution are going to be owned communally. The government and the commune, communist is where that word comes from. And the reason I'm going over this, I think we need to be aware of the things that are attacking our freedoms here in the country. And Ecclesiastes 12:13 says, let's hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God, keep his commandments. This is the whole duty of man. Fear God, keep his commandments. That's why we're here. And so Karl Marx believed that everything was an economic struggle, that you could trace everything back to an economic struggle. That is the battle between rich, poor, black, white, male, female. That explains everything. The politics, the religions, the laws and the culture. So everything can be traced back to an economic factor. Oh, my word. Well, you're exactly right. Many, many, many of our universities are just, they're bastions of socialism and communism. And these little, we're talking about even in elementary school, we're seeing infiltration of some really nasty stuff being taught to these kids. And so the conflict, here is what, there was a man by the name of Hegel, and here was, and it's called Hegel's dialectic. And this is the way that socialism works. Number one, that's called the thesis. And the thesis is the way things are. That's just the reality of the tax system. That's the reality of the way things are right now. Then there's the antithesis. And the antithesis is revolution against the thesis. Stir people up. Make them unhappy. Burn down businesses, march in the streets, tear things up, all this kind of stuff. So you've got your antithesis. And then you have the synthesis. And the synthesis is the new normal. Have you seen a new normal in this country in the last 50 years? Yeah. Don't think that was accidental. That was very, very much planned. And so Marxists believe that the synthesis, the new normal, is always better than the old normal. Yep. It does not work. It never has, it never will. Look at Argentina, France. I mean, look at places where the revolution was supposed to overturn, you know, this the haves and the have-nots, and that's what the French Revolution was all about. The American Revolution was a completely different deal. And so tens of millions, and I mean that literally, of unmarked graves are a reminder this worldview doesn't work. Now, number four, new spirituality. And it used to be called the New Age movement back several decades ago, actually. It's actually neo-paganism, and neo means new. It's a new form of paganism. And this is a radically un-Christian worldview. The worldview ranges anywhere from Hinduism to Buddhism. And understand, I don't have a personal problem with a Buddhist. I can be friends. I can never accept his philosophy of life. I'm not going to do that. If you're a Christian, don't be rude to people. You know, we don't have the right to do that. Don't ever do that. But I can never accept the atheist worldview. I cannot accept the agnostic worldview. I cannot. Now, I can talk with them and have. I've drawn that circle with a dot in the middle of it on a napkin in restaurants, and have talked with people before that did not believe there was a God. And you start out as an atheist, and at least you can bring them to be an agnostic, because they're not going to admit they don't know everything. Sure it does. And you probably shut the door to ever winning them to the Lord. But these people believe that everything is consciousness. Shirley MacLaine, Oprah Winfrey, these are evangelists for this point. Yes, sir. They're very much. There was a man by the name of Eckhart Tolle, who was a spiritualist guru, that said this, quote, "The whole is made up of existence and being." In other words, we're all part of God. Now, that's called pantheism. You're God, I'm God, the dogs are God, the birds, everything is God. And so he says, the whole is made up of existence and being, the manifested and unmanifested, the whole and God. So when you become aligned with the whole, you become part of the interconnectedness of the whole and its purpose, the emergence of consciousness into this world. In other words, everybody is God. Now, you remember in the Garden of Eden what the serpent told Eve? He said, you know why he doesn't want you to eat the fruit, right? Because you will be like him. Did you know that you can actually become little gods? And she believed it. She fell for it and ate the fruit. And that didn't happen. This stuff never does happen. It's all falsehood. It's all based on lies. But we keep falling for this stuff year after year after year. And so the New Ager wants to be free from himself through what's called a series of reincarnations. And y'all heard the term karma. Karma is not a good thing in this worldview, the Buddhists and these people. Karma is bad stuff. And so here's what you've got to do. You've got all this bad stuff, all these bad things you've done, all this hate, all the da-da-da-da-da. When you die, you come back as another form of life, and you have less of this karma. You got kind of washed off a little bit. But you still have karma. You've still got the bad stuff. So you die again, and you come back, and you die again. And eventually, the goal is to have all your karma washed off so that now you're perfect. That's what we're talking about. All right? To me, that is absolutely foolish to believe that. Let's look at this next one is postmodernism. We're looking at a reality that rose in, it was around the 1700s through the 1900s, that 200-year period. And this era explained reality through scientific investigation and empiricism. We can only know what our senses can perceive and see and smell and weigh and observe in the laboratory. But the postmodernist vehemently, and I mean vehemently with a capital V, rejects the idea of objective universal truth. Nothing is ever true all the time. It's constantly changing because science is always discovering new truth. Well, I can remember when science said the world was flat. They've changed their mind about that. Look at the things that they have changed their mind about through the centuries. Well, we used to think this. You remember, well, none of us remember this, but back many, many centuries ago, if you were sick, they would bleed. If you had a fever, they would bleed you. That was modern, contemporary medical procedure. Oh, goodness, he's got a fever. Let's bleed him. Guess who died as a result of that medical philosophy? George Washington. They bled the man to death. And so now we've kind of changed our minds. Matter of fact, now we have infusions. We used to bleed people. Now we give them blood. So is science always right? Good grief, no. It has been wrong about so many things. Pardon me, but COVID is one of them. Yeah, evolution is definitely one of them. And so the postmodernist rejects the idea that something is always right and something is always wrong. For instance, where in the world is murder okay? Nowhere. Japan. What about 1,000 years ago? Was murder okay 1,000 years ago? It's still wrong today. How about the second law of thermodynamics? Has it always been right? Yeah. And the second law of thermodynamics just simply says that the available amount of energy in a closed system is depleting. In other words, evolution says we're getting better. The reality is we're wearing out. And so I don't believe that. Look at your high school graduation picture. You think you're getting better? Take a look at that. And so things tend to wind down. The earth is wobbling on its axis. We're winding down, folks. We're getting ready to fall apart here. And so in the 20th century, people accepted the concrete nature of truth and specifically language. Words mean things. Words still mean things. And I want to share a word with you this morning in a message that in specifically in Greek and Hebrew, and even in English, and I'll give you an English example, you can use the same word and it have completely different meanings, and the context determines what it means. Here's the example. Sock. Now, if I say, I'm going to sock you. Okay, S-O-C-K. That has at least two meanings. It means I'm about ready to hit you, or I'm going to buy you a pair of socks. So, what does it mean? Context. Context. You know, if you're in a clothing store, somebody say, hey, I want to sock you, and you're pointing to the socks, well, the context says, okay, you're going to buy me a pair of socks. You get in a fight with somebody, I'm going to fix a sock you. We don't even use that term anymore, I don't think, but it means I'm going to hit you. And so, if you can deconstruct language so that the historic meaning of words no longer means the historic meaning, you can get people to believe anything. And I'm telling you, the internet is the champion of this kind of stuff, of changing language and reconstructing language. So to the postmodern mind, there is nothing that's always right and always wrong until, for instance, stealing. It's wrong to steal their stuff. You know what I'm saying? That's okay. And so when it becomes a very personal thing, then we've got a problem. But now let's look at the last thing, and that's Christianity. This is one of the major worldviews. And here is the Christian belief. God is the designer. He is the moral legislator of the universe. Anytime you have a law, you must, by definition, have a lawgiver. Okay? For instance, did speed limits come in the beginning when God created the heaven and the earth? Were there speed? Where'd that come from? How about hunting seasons? When could people hunt back 2,000 years ago? Anytime they wanted to. Anytime they wanted to. Now, from this date to that date, and you can't use a gun, you've got to use this, you can't do that, you can't. And so this stuff didn't evolve. We made up these laws. Now, are they good? In some instances, yes, laws can be very good. In many instances, we have codified abomination. Abortion, for instance. Just murder. It's the only crime where the victim is executed. And so that's a horrendous law. You say, but it's a law. You're right. It's legal, but it's wrong. And so everything that is legal is not necessarily right. Now, here's what we believe. We believe that there is an eternal God that is manifest in three distinct persons. I'm not a modalist, and a modalist is a person that believes that there's one person, one being, God. Sometimes he is the Son. Sometimes he is the Holy Spirit. He's in different modes. I don't believe that. I believe that there are three distinct persons, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That is not a descending order of importance. That's just the way they're listed in Scripture. And so this Godhead, the Scripture says, was responsible for the creation of all things, created man in his image. And when we fell, God designed a plan to redeem us back to being in harmony with himself again. And he did that through a system of Levitical economy in the Old Testament that was all temporary. And then Jesus came, and he, I don't want to get into it because what we're going to be talking about this morning, but a person can become a child of God through being born again. We're born once physically. Can you ever be born physically more than once? Can you be born spiritually more than once? No. You know, your salvation is an eternal covenant. And it is a covenant, but that covenant is not between us and God. The covenant is between God the Father and God the Son. And so that covenant is an eternal covenant. So if you're saved, you're saved forever. Now, which worldview, and we've talked about several this morning, which one best explains the condition of the world and the presence of mankind? All right, there are several tests. I'm going to read these to you, and then we'll be done. Number one, there is the test of reason. Is it reasonable to believe that an explosion created order? Not even reasonable to believe that to me. I mean, that's a foolish thing. There's the test of the outer world. You know, what does that mean? Well, the test of the outer world means, is there evidence to support your belief? Where can you find evidence of evolution, for instance? Nowhere. Now, you know as well as I do that if evolution was a fact, that at some point in history, the transitional species would have died. It wasn't going to work out, and so this monkey man would have died because of some physical... And you know that fossil would have been found somewhere. Has that fossil ever been found? No. See, they don't need the link. They got the link. They need the chain. You know? Y'all have heard of Piltdown Man. Piltdown Man. This was discovered in Piltdown Common, Sussex, England, many, many years ago, 200-300 years ago. And it was a skull, the jawbone, and it was printed in scientific journals. Oh, my goodness. We have found the missing link, yada, 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 yada. And then about 50 years later, it was discovered that a guy took the skull of a person and the jawbone of an orangutan, painted them with acid to give them the appearance of age, and buried it in the ground. And these idiot scientists came along and dug it up. So we found it. Do you know that is still listed in scientific books today as a historical reality, Piltdown Man, even though it was proven to be a hoax? And so is it even reasonable? And the answer is no. And then there's the test just of the real world. Look around you. Go outside. Just look at the world. Who did that? Who did that? You got pine trees and oak trees. So at some point, one decides, well, I'm gonna evolve into a pine tree. Okay, you do the pine thing, I'll do the oak thing. I mean, really, when you look at the reality of things, it is absolutely unreasonable to believe that we got here by accident. It really is. And so what worldview has more evidence internally and externally than any other worldview in the world? Christianity. And I'm not saying that because I'm a Christian, and I'm definitely a Christian. I'm telling you that's why I am a Christian. Because there is proof. The resurrection is a tenet of my faith because it's a fact of history. This is not just some philosophical, let's tell the kids a cute story before they go to bed. The resurrection is the most easily defined, the most easily proven fact in history. It is. And so, I'm with David when David said, the Lord's my shepherd, I shall not want. And what he meant was, I shall not want another shepherd. I'm not looking for anybody else. I'm not looking for another Savior. I'm not looking for another Redeemer. I have found the lover of my soul, and he is the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, sir. It's in Turin, Italy. Yep. And they bring it out every 5 years. Yeah. I've got some problems with that being the shroud of Christ. But anyway. All right. Thank you all for being here. I appreciate your presence. We'll take a little bit of a break, and then we'll get started here. And good to see everybody. Hope you had a good week. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your goodness. We praise you. We honor you. We give you our lives, our minds. We give you our everything that we have. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for who you are and what you've done in our lives. Bless our service to follow in Jesus' name. Amen.
He's our rescuer. Every chain will break, as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is a lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb, the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him. Open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power in fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb. The Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him.
Thank you, baby.
Good job, guys. Good morning, everybody. How are you doing? Who got a little bit of rain last night? Man, it was a trash floater all over the place. How many first-time visitors, or you've not been here like in a long, long time? Would you raise your hand? All right, we're glad to have this. Y'all got the gift bag, right? We got that. Who else? Did we miss anybody? First-time visitors? We'll raise your hand. All right. Thank you for being here. It's an honor to have you with us. Well, tell me about your week. I need to hear some good reports. What's the Lord been doing for you? Yes. Wow. That could have been deadly. That could have been deadly. All right. Yes, sir. You what? You got married a couple of weeks ago. Yes. Very good. Very good. Congratulations. That's good. All right. Anybody else got married a couple of weeks ago? No. All right. Anybody else? it was a couple of weeks ago. Happy anniversary at 50? May 17th. 50 years ago. Wow. That's a half a century. My mom was holding me. Yeah, mom. Yes, I was. Yes, I was. All right, anybody else? Thankful for the rain. Yes, exactly. Yes. He really has. He really has. And by the way, yes, camp starts tomorrow. I think we've got 31 total going to camp. If you're going to camp, we need to meet with you real quickly right after service right here in the front. Need to get we got the trailer? Okay. And if you let me know when, I'll go get it. And so we'll have a real, real quick meeting. It's probably going to be a little cool up there. We're trying. Became acquainted. Right. Amen. All right. Great ministry. It is. All right. Anybody else? I didn't shake your hand. How you doing, man? Good. Good to see you. Good to see you. Sitting right up front. Now this is good. Now something's going on. It's exactly right. It's exactly right. All right. Anybody else? Okay. Yes, ma'am. Okay. Well, glad he's doing better. All right. Anybody else? Good. Pardon? Jamie, this was Ashley's. Yeah. Yes, Ashley's husband. All right. Anything else? Y'all are a good-looking crowd this morning. If you're sitting next to somebody that just looks really sharp this morning, would you raise your hand? You're going to need to go to a chiropractor when he gets through jerking your shoulder. Oh, my goodness. Yes, sir. Football season. When did that start? Okay. All right. Well, that's good. All right. Ushers? Yes, sir. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. Most certainly do. Yes, ma'am. Okay, that's Thursday, Tuesday. Okay, all right. Keep that request in mind. Anybody else? All right, well, let's pray. Well, ushers, if you'll come first, and we'll receive our... Oh, y'all looking good this morning. I like that little curve up here. How are you doing? Good to see you. All right. All right, let's pray. Father, we bow this morning to worship and to praise you and you alone. You're the only God there is. There are so many in this world that claim to be gods. But you and you alone are to be worshiped and praised. We thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for sending your Son in our likeness to die for our sin. What a wonderful truth that is. And I pray that you bless the request this morning. Be what is needed in each case. And I pray that when we leave here, that we'll be different. I don't want to just come to church and hear stuff and go home. I want my heart to be changed. And I pray that you would meet us in your word today and change our very lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Could everybody please stand and sing with us?
Lost are saved, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned feel no shame at the sound of your great name. Every fear has no place at the sound of your great name. The enemy, he has to leave at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. The Son of God, amen, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise your great name. All the weak find their strength at the sound your great name. Hungry souls receive grace at the sound of your great name. The fatherless, they find their rest at the sound of your great name. The sick are healed, the dead are raised at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. The Son of God, amen, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise healer, Lord Almighty. My Savior, defender, you are my King. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. The Son of God, amen, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise your great name. Your great name. Your great name.
Thank y'all. Great job. I appreciate that. Are you comfortable, by the way? Is anybody too cold? Are my glasses, they feel like they're messed up a little bit here. What? Okay, is that better? Is that, are they still crooked? Well, what? Hold on. Security, can we? Security. All right, how's that? Is that better? I don't, all right. Well, I